Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene welcomes you to the 2015 Manson Christmas Lecture, which comes to you. Video stream from the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene. The event will start at 10 a.m. Thank you for your patience. Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene. The event will start at 10 a.m. Thank you for your patience. live video stream from the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene. The event will start at 10 a.m. Thank you for your patience. This live video stream from the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene. The event will start at 10 a.m. Thank you for your patience. Welcome to this live video stream from the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene. The event will start at 10 a.m. Thank you for your patience. Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene welcomes you to the 2015 Manson Christmas Lecture, which comes to you live from the Institute of Education in London. This year's lecture will be presented by Professor Charlotte Watts from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, who will be discussing the challenges and opportunities in addressing adolescent women's vulnerability to HIV in sub-Saharan Africa. The lecture will start at 10 a.m. and will finish at 11 a.m. The Manson Christmas Lecture forms the opening plenary of the RSTMH Research in Progress 2015 meeting. Further details about the Research in Progress 2015 event can be found on the RSTMH website. Please follow at RSTMH on Twitter for live updates from the event throughout the day. We will now go live to the Institute of Education in London for the 2015 Manson Christmas Lecture.
Lecture, and also I'm chairing today for the Research in Progress meeting. So, a couple of housekeeping notes. There's fire exit over there and there. If there's a loud alarm, you'll be allowed to leave. If you've got mobile phones that you need to keep on, please have them on vibrate or keep them on silent, please, so we don't disturb our speakers today. As I say, welcome to Research in Progress. It's a long-standing Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene meeting held every year for early career investigators, and it's central to the strategic focus of the Society. We have prizes awarded today, both for the oral presentations and the posters. And the posters will be displayed in the room next door, so please do go and look at those during the lunch break and the afternoon tea break. I understand we're also having one of the prize winners from last year to present again today. So we're filming today and we're streaming live this morning. We're streaming the whole day, Jerry? Just this morning, just the Manson Christmas Lecture. So welcome to everybody who is watching online. Today we have 14 institutions represented from the UK and from outside of the UK. And we've also got visitors from overseas with us today, and several supervisors have made the effort to come along today. So welcome to them, and welcome to everybody who's working with them. We've got guests from Spain, the Netherlands, Belgium, and the Czech Republic. Perhaps not all here just yet, but hopefully throughout the day they will be turning up. Just a little few mentions about things that the Society are doing. Forthcoming meetings in January, actually in February now, topics in infection, TB meeting in March, and epidemiological transitions meeting next year in Kenya. And next September we have our big biennial meeting in Cambridge, which is about challenges in disease elimination. You can get full details of all of these outside with the team, some of who are sitting in here, but will be available to speak to at lunchtime and during the breaks. They've got information about the journals, and their copies of the journals will be available outside, and you can talk to them about membership and also the grants round, which will close in January next year, January 2016. And the team will have information about those as well. So, on to this morning's initial lecture, the Manson Christmas Lecture. This is also an annual event for the Society and has been going on for many years now. I asked Jerry to check this morning, but she didn't have the exact figure. More than 100 years? The Society is more than 100 years old now, but obviously not had this for that long. So to deliver the lecture today, it gives me great pleasure to welcome Professor Charlotte Watts, who is sat here with me. I'm going to say a few words about Charlotte, which I hope I get correct. We've been checking this morning. Charlotte is the founder and head of the Social and Mathematical Epidemiological Group and founder of the Gender Violence and Health Centre at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. Charlotte trained as a mathematician originally and then went on to study epidemiology, economics and social sciences. She's conducted and still conducts research on HIV and combines a focus on women's vulnerability to HIV and violence with innovation in mathematical modelling to project epidemiological and other outcomes. Charlotte was elected to the Fellowship of the Academy of Medical Sciences this year in May and seconded to DFID, the Department for International Development, as Chief Scientific Advisor in October 2015. Charlotte will be delivering her Manson Christmas Lecture today on addressing adolescent women's vulnerability to HIV in sub-Saharan Africa, the challenges and opportunities. Charlotte will deliver her lecture, and then we'll have an opportunity to ask questions, both from those who are watching this being live streamed and from the audience. We will have microphones for the audience here. If people would like to ask a question, they can put their hands up, please introduce themselves and say where they come from. So I think, without further ado, I've covered everything I needed to cover. It will give me great pleasure to introduce Professor Charlotte Watts to deliver the Manson Christmas Lecture. Thank you.
Will it come up here, or...?
Presentation mode.
Oh, no, this isn't my slide. That's your presentation. So I will just correct a couple of facts while we find my slides. They're down on the left. Brilliant. There's one important correction I need to make, which is that I was the head of the gender the Social Mathematical Epidemiology Group, and my successor has walked in the door, and I would have corrected anyway, but I particularly have to make that correction given that you're sitting here. So Professor Graham Medley has taken over in that role now that I'm predominantly at DFID, but I still maintain one day a week at the school working in these areas, and I'm also very pleased to see that my former student is actually presenting later on as well, related to her work on this topic. So I've just got to sort out the technology and this. I'm going to be talking about addressing adolescent girls' vulnerability to HIV in sub-Saharan Africa. And what I want to give you a feel of is what are some of the
the challenges, but I don't want to dwell completely on the challenges, because I think that's what we tend to, we can do quite well in some of our fields at times about saying how difficult it is, but actually, you know, we really in public health have to think about, well, what are the opportunities and how do we move forward to really address important public health challenges. But to give you a flavour of the challenge, these are figures from UNAIDS from 2013 that estimate that there are 2.1 million adolescents who are living with HIV. And the greatest burden in terms of adolescents living with HIV is in sub-Saharan Africa. And this map has all these sort of colourful circles, which basically represent different subgroups who have HIV. And I don't want you to sort of get over bogged down in analysing the size of the different groups, but if you look at sub-Saharan Africa, you'll see that the biggest circle is young women. And so in sub-Saharan Africa, when we look at the distribution of infection amongst adolescents, it's predominantly young women as a whole. So there are also clearly infections amongst other marginalized groups, so young women who are sex workers, for example, young men who have sex with men, and other vulnerable groups. But we're seeing a large number of infections amongst the broad adolescent sexually active population in sub-Saharan Africa. We also see similar findings when we look at, well, what are the numbers of infections that occur globally? And sort of what these figures suggest is that over 7,000 new infections every week occur amongst young women globally. And this plot shows you the estimates of the numbers across different sub-Saharan African countries. So what stands out very clearly is the large number of infections amongst adolescent women in South Africa, but also large numbers of infections across other countries in the region. So this issue of adolescent vulnerability is huge in itself, but if we're looking forward, we also have to recognize that the population demographics are changing. And so what this plot does is show you projections of the size of the adolescent population around the world. And so you can see from, if you look at all those various curves there, it's for different regions. So that light blue curve, for example, is for East Asia and the Pacific. And in a lot of the countries, the sort of size of the adolescent population has increased and is projected to go down. But if you look at sub-Saharan Africa, excuse me, that solid blue line, you can see that's the one that is just steadily increasing. So when we think of this high vulnerability to HIV amongst adolescents, we also have that population is increasing. So actually, to impact on the absolute numbers of infections averted, we have to do even better than we are currently to actually dent on the absolute numbers because of that growing underlying size of that population. And actually, we aren't doing very well on denting on the numbers per se, let alone thinking about what does this translate to over time as that population increases in size. The other issue around thinking about HIV vulnerability amongst adolescents and adolescent women is actually it's the population where we really struggle to know how best to intervene. So if you think about the field of HIV, we've had huge successes. It's an area where, as a field where actually our arsenal of prevention options has continually expanded. There's a lot of effective interventions that have reduced HIV incidence. So things like male circumcision, focused interventions with sex workers, with other vulnerable populations, new evidence that shows that widespread treatment and early treatment can prevent onward transmission, evidence that shows taking ARTs as a prevention prophylaxis is also effective. So actually our options are quite strong. But when it comes to adolescents, we somewhat struggle around what forms of interventions are effective. And this is a slide that just summarizes a review of reviews that a colleague of mine, James Hargreaves, did at the London School. And it looked at, well, do we have any success when we look at education programs in school? And although there is evidence that those programs are useful, they increase knowledge, they increase understanding. Actually, in terms of trials that have tried to assess whether there's an impact on HIV incidence, we aren't seeing any success. So it's one of those sort of big challenges in the HIV prevention world. So to expand a bit more about the issues around when we're thinking about adolescent girls and their vulnerability, what social epidemiology, what social science points out very clearly is that it's complicated. If we think about adolescents' vulnerability, there might be issues around age that come into play, so issues around whether at a young age you might be more risk prone, be it to be influences your peer group, of your cognitive development stage and so on, that might influence your propensity to take risk or your sort of thinking about the trade-offs of doing something risky in the immediate term versus weighing up the potential longer term consequences of that behavior. There are important issues around poverty, and particularly when we think of adolescent girls, the issue of using sex as an asset. So issues of trading sex, be it to access to resources, be it access to employment opportunities, be it out of a desire of consumerism, to access different sorts of commodities. There's a sort of a key issue that comes up in terms of when we think about factors underpinning adolescent girls' vulnerability. Linked to that are the sort of gender issues around, well, why might a girl end up trading sex or using sex as a way to access resources, which is in the broader sphere of potentially limited education opportunities or access to employment opportunities or other ways to actually achieve the aspirations that she may have. There are also barriers that cut across the HIV field, but also may be sort of doubly layered when we think of adolescence around issues around stigma, about thinking about sex, talking about sex, acknowledging you're sexually active, negotiating a condom use in a relationship, and underpinning that gender inequalities. What I want to talk a bit more about today is the issue around violence, because this is an area that's starting to come up very strongly on in terms of evidence and emerging as quite an important theme within this sort of clustering of vulnerabilities that we need to engage with if we're going to think about how best to address adolescent girls' vulnerability to HIV. So to give you a sense of the global figures, this is a paper we produced a few years ago that summarized and synthesized population data from around the world about the extent to which women will experience physical or sexual violence from an intimate partner. And this map gives you the sort of average figures, the aggregate figures by region around the world. And if we look at sub-Saharan Africa, the estimates are that 36% of women will experience physical or sexual violence from a partner in their lifetime. So this is an issue that's a very common reality in women's lives, yet it's something that actually in public health terms and in many other spheres of life has been somewhat hidden or seen as an issue that's a bit too tricky for us to kind of get into and handle, yet is slightly the elephant in the room when we're thinking about adolescence and more broadly about women's vulnerability to HIV or other aspects of challenge that they might face in their lives. So this slide is for women of reproductive age, so kind of based on surveys of women of 15 to 49. This slide, which isn't very clear, I'm afraid. I've just cut and pasted it from a UNICEF report that came out just a month ago, shows national data across a range of sub-Saharan African countries that you can't actually read, probably, I'm afraid, but that gives you the percentage of women who've been ever forced to have sex. That's the dark blue bar. And then I've been forced to have sex in the past 12 months. So that's the yellow bar. So even though you can't clearly disaggregate the figures, and I'm not going to test you on them at the end, what I want you to just look at is, firstly, how common it is. So the first light bar, that line that I hope you can see, is the 10% figure. So if we look at the countries at the top, we've got a number of sub-Saharan African countries where more than 10% of adolescents have experienced sexual violence. And actually, when we look at the yellow bars, it's, you know, we're in the sort of 7 to 10% figure ranges in terms of having experienced sexual violence in the past year. These are the figures for sexual violence. When you look at the figures for physical violence in relationships or outside relationships, they're pretty similar, if anything higher, and add up to the sort of 1 in 3 figure that I showed you in the previous slide. So when people look at violence data around sexual violence and adolescence, they tend to think, oh, it's that stranger rape. It's that, you know, a girl's been attacked on the street. But when you disaggregate this data, yes, that form of sexual violence does occur, but actually the majority of the sexual violence that's reported is by intimate partners. So that might be a boyfriend, it might be a husband, a spouse. And so the bulk of the sexual violence, when we look at the epidemiological data, is in within intimate relationships, although there are also risks from other perpetrators as well. So, okay, I'm showing you this data on violence, and I hope there's some cynics in the room who say, well, what's that got to do with HIV? There's a little bit of sexual violence. Is that really kind of explaining the sort of high incidence in this group? And I don't believe it's the whole reason why we're seeing this high incidence by any means, but I want to talk you through a little bit what we think is going on this, and then more broadly discuss how violence and the fear of violence impacts on women's ability to negotiate and protect themselves from HIV. So to get into the data about what we know about the relationship with exposures to violence and incident HIV infection, there was a systematic review published a couple of years ago, and these two tables summarize the results from cohort studies and HIV infection. So the first one is really just synthesizing two studies, both of which are quite small, that looked at the relationship between exposure to physical violence and incident HIV infection and found evidence of an increased risk. The second plot is looking at any form of exposure to partner violence, so it might be physical or sexual, and association with HIV risk. So I put that first one up because I think it's interesting, because when we think about the association between violence and HIV, people tend to think, well, it's the sexual violence and there might be genital trauma, and there are these pathways that, you know, we could expect to be sort of associated with increased HIV susceptibility. But what the epidemiological evidence points to, and it's very small, I'm being very open about the limits of the data, is actually it's not solely sexual violence that emerges as being important in terms of it being associated with increased risk. This is to illustrate this. Again, this is the results from a cohort study in South Africa conducted by Rachel Jukes and colleagues at the MRC in South Africa that looked at the association between exposures to physical and sexual violence and HIV risk and found an increased incidence rate ratio, but also found, if you can see the second circle, the top circle, an increased risk with inequality in the relationship. So there's the issue of sexual violence, physical and sexual violence, other forms of violence, more importantly, but also what's coming out from this study is the suggestion that actually there's the broader issue around gender inequality and power inequalities in the relationship, which might be a key issue in underpinning increased HIV risk. What's coming out from some other research more recently is also issues such as controlling behavior and verbal abuse as being associated with HIV risk. So when we try and tease that and go, well, what are the pathways? What's really going on here? What we end up with is quite a complicated picture that really gives us insights into that actually there are multiple pathways. There's lots of things going on that lead to that association that we're seeing epidemiologically between exposures to different forms of violence and incident HIV. And so you've got at this top level, sorry, have we got a pointer? At the top level, we've got the sort of broader structural issues. So some of the stuff I was talking about sort of poverty and economic stress, gender inequality, equality and social norms that might condone the use of violence, and social constructions of masculinity and femininity that might support the use of violence or the tolerance of violence. And these feed into factors related to the man who may be using violence and a woman who's experiencing violence, and their likelihood of actually having violence within a relationship. We also see pathways around early childhood exposures to violence, and that might feed into the likelihood that violence occurs, which for women might, again, lead into issues around different aspects around psychological distress, which may directly influence issues around biological susceptibility to HIV, but also might have pathways through leading to women having higher risk behaviors, which are associated with increased risk of HIV. If we think about the pathways linked to men, similarly, we see that men's exposure to violence in childhood is very associated with their likelihood of using violence in their relationships and later life. So these histories of trauma, along with broader social norms and constructions that might support the use of violence, play into the likelihood that men may use violence. But also we see these constructions feeding into a clustering of other risk behaviours. So we see associations between, we tend to see a clustering of behaviours, so the men who may be buying sex or binge drinking may also be using violence in their relationship. And because of that clustering of risk, those men might in turn be at higher risk of being HIV infected, which is then how we see in our epidemiological studies this association between violence and, in the end, the increased likelihood of HIV, along with characteristics of that relationship. So, for example, potentially difficulties around negotiating safer sex practice, accessing HIV information and preventive services, and may pose challenges in terms of adherence to things like antiretrovirals. So it's a complicated picture, and sadly that's what the data suggests. It's complicated and there are multiple pathways. Most of my talk is focused on prevention, and we're thinking about how do we design interventions to reduce the incidence of HIV amongst adolescent women. But it's important to flag up, both because the value in its own right, but also because the link of treatment and future prevention, is that there's evidence that violence and the fear of violence may also impact on women's ability to engage in HIV treatment and care. So, for example, there are a range of different studies amongst pregnant women that suggest that anticipated violence, so the fear of violence, is associated with women refusing HIV testing, that in relationships, if you look at the opposite, where men are engaged and there are sort of is a more equal relationship, we do see better adherence to nevirapine. We see that women who are experiencing physical violence are less likely to uptake antenatal care, which is our entry point into for women to get HIV testing and access to prevention of mother-to-child treatments, as well as HIV treatment more broadly. And also some evidence about a history of violence decreases women's likelihood of breastfeeding or the duration of breastfeeding. Similarly, there's a lot of both quantitative and qualitative data from research with women who are infected with HIV. And again, the issue of violence comes out very strongly. So about the fear of violence, lengthening the time that women take in terms of accessing care, decreases ART uptake, is related to low adherence to antiretroviral treatment, and with, in the end, poor HIV-related outcomes, so and so increased virologic failure and opportunistic infection. Another interesting finding that's coming out when we think of adolescence is related to when we think of some of the new paradigms and the new technologies that we're starting to get for HIV prevention, so in particular PrEP, so pre-exposure prophylaxis. And this is a plot that just summarizes the results across the range of different PrEP trials that have been conducted. And these have been conducted in a range of different populations. And you can see that some of them have shown effectiveness, some the error bars across one, the line seems to have moved, and some have found haven't found significance. The trials in the end that have had most problems in terms of adherence have been the trials that have had adolescent women involved in them. And it's interesting because some of the PROUD trial, for example, is a trial working with men who have sex with men. And actually that trial achieved high levels of adherence and showed an effect. And we, you know, I mean, the evidence points to that PrEP works if it's used consistently. And so this variation in our trial results reflects the different populations and whether or not they're able to actually adhere consistently to PrEP. And when we have the greatest challenge is adolescent women. Okay, so I've given you a sense of the challenges and some of the pathways that we need to be thinking about when we're thinking about how to address adolescent women's vulnerability to HIV. I now want to move on to some of the thinking that we've been doing around prevention opportunities. And when we think about prevention opportunities, it's very easy to think about it. You know, I come from an HIV background, to just think about it in terms of HIV. But actually, if you think about global development and if we think about broader health agenda, it's actually really important when we think about what are the possibilities to raise our head and to take a step back and go, actually, how do we, are we missing tricks and opportunities if we keep a narrow focus? And to illustrate this, this is a piece of analysis that a colleague of mine from the school did, looking at just taking DHS data from Malawi and saying, okay, who are the women who are getting married early? Who are the women who are experiencing violence? Who are the women who haven't gone on to secondary education? And what do we know about the relationship between them? And also, what do we know about those groups and different health outcomes? So not only HIV, but different sexual and reproductive health indicators and different maternal and child health indicators. And actually, if you think about the underlying drivers, it's not surprising they're all connected, right? So it's the same women who are vulnerable to, you know, we see high levels of violence amongst women who've been married early, who haven't achieved secondary education, for example. And similarly, that all of those sort of upstream factors are linked to poor outcomes, be it vulnerability to HIV, to poor sexual and reproductive health, or different aspects of maternal and child health. So, I mean, the joke is that on Monday, you know, if we're doing our public health messaging, on Monday we go and talk to an adolescent about rape, on Tuesday we talk to her about pregnancy, on Wednesday we talk to her about something else. And so I think the challenge for the public health community is to say, how do we join up our thinking and our service response and our prevention response to recognize that clustering of vulnerabilities. And that provides us a lot of opportunities to actually get more efficient and maybe then do more better within the particularly vulnerable populations. So to give you a sense, and just going back to this, I've talked about this in terms of health outcomes, but we could also look at it in terms of different economic indicators as well. And so these multiple vulnerabilities aren't related to health alone, but also to many other areas. So, okay, to give you a sense of the kind of interventions that people are doing that are trying to take on board this issue of violence, of gender inequality, of limited economic opportunity, and say, well, how do we design and test interventions that recognize that complex space and those multiple challenges? The evidence base is limited. the sort of the research field is a stage where we're testing things, we're trying things, often on a small scale, and so there's a lot more to be done. But I want to give you a flavour of some of the interventions and some of their preliminary results. So the first one is, I think, a really interesting intervention that brought together stepping stones. So that's a participatory gender transformative intervention that really works with boys and girls, adolescent boys and adolescent girls, to really think about constructions of what it means to be a man, what it means to be a woman, issues around violence, about control, around violence, the use of violence in relationships, around communication, negotiation. So really supports adolescents to rethink issues that they might have grown up sort of thinking it's one way, but to challenge some of those assumptions, but also support the development of new skills and thinking about different ways of having relationships. And they paired that with an intervention called Creating Futures, which was an economic livelihood program, and it's really supporting adolescents, in this case in South Africa, to better equip them to get into the job market. And so there are sort of a range of sort of financial literacy training activities to work on your CV, to think about how to apply and get interviewed for jobs, and all these sort of various skills that might be useful for adolescents. And combine that and say, well, what might be the impacts if we bring those together? And they've done, they did a shortened interrupted time series evaluation. So, you know, it's sort of a first phase of evaluation of this combination. And what those findings suggest is, in terms of the livelihood side, there was an improvement in earnings, that there was generally, the participants felt happier about work. There was reported less stealing because they were hungry. So these are kids who are at the margins. There were some good mental health outcomes for men. There was good signs around positive, improved relationships with their partners. And the adolescent women also reported experiencing less intimate partner violence. Now, this combined intervention is going on now and is in a trial, a large randomized controlled trial that actually DFID are supporting. So it'll be interesting to see, well, do those outcomes hold when you go to a sort of more rigorous form of evaluation? But actually, this combined economic and gender transformative package is an area that's looking very promising. And so there have been also other trials with older populations of women where that combination has been used. And generally, we're tending to see that there are impacts both on violence and different indicators of HIV risk. And this study suggests that actually this might be a combination that might work for adolescents in particular. The second trial I wanted to flag up was a trial that was published in Lancet Global Health last year, and it was called the SHARE trial, and it was a cluster randomized trial that brought together again an integrated violence and HIV prevention package. And in this case, it was focused on the community. It had a number of different components. So there was community level work of advocacy, awareness raising around issues around gender, HIV. There was focus work in health services, so thinking about how do we train health providers to ask around issues of violence, to respond appropriately if women are fearing violence once they get HIV tested, to support them through that sort of testing and disclosure process. There was work with men in the community, as well as women in the community, around activism to change social norms. So it's quite a complex intervention, but really trying to piece off different pieces of that sort of complex puzzle. And what that trial found was a significant reduction, in the short term at least, on HIV incidents. There was also reductions in participants' reported experience of sexual violence and physical violence, and reports of increased disclosure in HIV results. So this trial, it's again relatively small, but does have some potentially promising results in terms of biological outcomes. I think there are some still questions about, well, what's going on? What are the pathways under that underlying those results? In the longer term, the incidence levels did equalize again. So there's also the sort of questions about, well, if we do these interventions, are the effects sustained? Or actually, do we need top-ups or to do other activities to achieve impacts in the longer term, but again, a sort of promising indicator of how different combinations of intervention packages could potentially be effective in terms of reducing vulnerability to HIV and also to violence and other outcomes. And then the third example I want to flag up is one that I'm sure several of you have heard about, which is the Zomba cash transfer program. So this wasn't a health intervention. This was an intervention implemented by the World Bank that basically gave a cash transfer to girls to stay in school. It was a conditional cash transfer. And what was interesting about it was that that payment of cash, when they looked at the HIV outcome at the end, there was HIV prevalence amongst adolescents who received in the intervention arm had a 64% lower prevalence of HIV than an intervention arm. So I was saying at the start, we don't know how to address adolescent girls' vulnerability to HIV. This was an intervention that actually didn't go and distribute condoms or talk about ABC or any of that, but found a reduction in HIV. And it speaks to that importance of those structural issues. I think the other issue which is really interesting when you look at this is it didn't only impact on HIV, it also had a reduction, it led to a reductions in rates of school dropout, early marriage, HSV2 risk, and teen pregnancies. So it was an intervention that actually achieved multiple outcomes both in the health and education spheres by setting up a conditional cash transfer. So after this, in the kind of international community, there was this flurry of enthusiasm and we need to do conditional cash transfers everywhere to keep girls in school. What's interesting, when the trialists went to look at the data, actually the conditionality, they didn't see differences in terms of HIV prevalence between girls who only got a payment if they stayed in school versus a payment irrespective of if they were in school or not. So there's this question of, is it the money or is it the conditionality in being in school? Isn't so clear. And subsequently, there's been a trial in South Africa, the Swakopmund trial, that did the same conditional cash transfer and looked at HIV incidence, so a stronger design. And in that case, they found a flat result. So they had no impact on HIV incidence. So we're left with that question about, well, there's this potential that we're seeing in Malawi, but actually in South Africa, we haven't seen it play out. Is that a result of the different contexts, the different underlying HIV incidence levels that those girls are subject to, or are there other elements that are going on that relate to the potentially context-specific nature of the interventions? Another study in Botswana that looked at a natural experiment where the Botswanan government had removed fees, so basically made it possible for girls to have additional years of to stay in school, did some quite clever analyses that does suggest that actually additional years of education or keeping girls in school for additional years was associated with associated reductions in HIV risk. But anyway, I think this, for me, the sort of what's interesting about this is this joining up our thinking about multiple vulnerabilities and other interventions that help us hit multiple outcomes in one intervention package. So I'm going to conclude here in terms of my talk. I hope I've given you a sense of both. Primarily the urgent need to address adolescent women's vulnerability to HIV. It's an area, I think, in terms of the challenges for HIV of the future, this is the big challenge. You know, we know what to do in a lot of the other areas. I mean, there are challenges around sustained funding and all of these things, but actually in terms of what are the packages that we know and are tested that we can use for different vulnerable populations, adolescent girls in sub-Saharan Africa in particular, is a huge challenge, and it's something that needs more investment and attention. The challenges are because the drivers are multiple. There are issues that I've been talking about economic vulnerability, gender norms, violence, and the fear of violence. And they play out both in the individual relationship and structural level. And violence is something that is emerged quite strongly now as an area that is potentially important when we think about risk and the drivers of risk and the extent to which adolescent girls can negotiate and protect themselves from HIV. I think the field in terms of the prevention evidence space is really interesting. It's small, and we get conflicting results. But I think it is starting to point the way towards the need for us to invest in combination and think more carefully about combination interventions. And I always think if we're going to make the financial case for investing in combination interventions that kind of might involve the health sector and communities and so on, actually we need to get very smart about understanding the breadth of benefits that we might get linked to those sort of more complex intervention models. And encouragingly, I think what the evidence starts to suggest is actually those interventions might be complex and need multiple elements, but actually the returns might be high and they might span many areas, both within health and broader economic development. I haven't gone into the sort of unpacking what are the components that we know about successful interventions, but the kind of issues that you see in the intervention models that seem to be effective are ones that don't just go and teach, they really seek to empower adolescents. They support critical reflection and dialogue, they're very participatory, they build skills, they challenge established assumptions around gender, around relationships, around use of violence. Having an economic component seems to be important as well. And that might be both to do with addressing economic vulnerabilities, but also I think it's a potentially interesting platform. People on the whole might be more motivated, if you're in a poor community, to come to an intervention that offers an economic opportunity, and then there might be these other layers of issues that also people get involved in, than if we solely go out and try and do an intervention package that doesn't have that economic element. So I think that there's sort of synergies in many different ways. But as a researcher, of course, I'm always kind of saying that more research is needed because the field is at an early stage. So in sort of reflections of moving forward, I think it's actually quite a good time to be starting to think about health within the broader sort of development context and the opportunities that this gives us when we're thinking about addressing adolescent vulnerability to HIV and other poor health outcomes. So I'm sure all of you know the SDGs and the multiple range of areas that the social development goals are seeking to challenge. We have health, we've gone from MDGs with health, had multiple indicators and very disease-specific indicators, to a situation where we have health as one of many, many important areas that the field of development needs to be engaging with and tackling. But actually, when you think about the kind of intervention packages that I'm talking about, you know, it spans that sort of middle right set of bubbles. So health, education, gender inequality, and actually we could get down to employment and inequality in other ways. So actually, I think as the development community starts to say, well, how do we start thinking more holistically? Actually, this sort of thinking that is spanning how do we get most effect from different combinations of intervention packages that could give us benefits across different SDG areas. Hopefully, this debate will create new space for that kind of thinking. It's not going to be easy because it means working across sectors, across disciplines. Even within health, we're not always very good at that, let alone thinking about reaching out to education and gender and so on, but I think that's the direction of flow that we need to engage with. So that's it. I want, for people who are interested in this topic, just flag up a useful resource. There's a DFID research program consortium that I was involved with before moving to DFID that's still very active at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine that does a range of different research on the structural drivers of HIV and does a lot of work in this area around thinking about adolescents and their HIV vulnerability. And it's a very live website. It has learning labs It has a number of different resources. So please, if you're interested, do check out just Google Strive and the London School and you'll find it. And this is a partnership with organisations in South Africa, Tanzania, India and the US as well. So it's got quite a global focus. And just get back to the start of my talk about the need to address adolescents' vulnerability. So I've been talking for maybe 40 minutes or something like that. We'll have a bit of a chat. We'll finish in an hour. And over that time, there'll be 26 new HIV infections will have occurred amongst adolescents. Thanks.
Thank you, Charlotte. That was an extremely interesting and insightful lecture. Do we have questions from the floor? We have a roving microphone. If people would like to ask a question, we have put their hand up. Just quickly say who you are and where you're from. It would be helpful. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Constance Mackworth-Young from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. Thank you very much for your lecture. It was really interesting. One of the things that it made me reflect on was how violence among adolescent girls impacts how they're sort of seen or how they interact with maybe older women, mothers, and from my experience in Zambia, the fear of violence and the fear of sexual violence actually makes mothers or older women be very protective over adolescent girls, and then the impact that that has on what they're allowed to do and sometimes maybe the secrecy that they have to act in. And I was just wondering about your reflections on the impact of this violence on how they're treated.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really good point. And I mean, I was trying to bring out the issue about it's not only violence, it's the fear of violence. And it's what that means for, you're right, I mean, it's not only how it impacts on an individual girl's behavior, but also how it impacts on family members' behavior. And there might be issues around then what might be the constraints that are put on that girl if, you know, in relation to try and manage that risk. There are also issues around if a girl has been raped, what might be the sort of blame and stigma that she might experience that, or sort of ways of fixing that issue. So, for example, marrying a girl off if she becomes pregnant from being raped, for example, that, you know, have huge repercussions. So you're right. I mean, it's an area that, you know, it's a really important issue.
Okay, thank you. We have two questions on this side.
Hello, my name's Isabel. I'm completing my PhD at Imperial College. I work on another population, but I do work on HIV. I had a question. It was really interesting, and I agree with your conclusions about the combinations of different interventions. I think one of the key challenges is that how do you implement interventions that address critical thinking, obviously, that is required, but address certain norms that in the broader society may not be accepted. Yeah. So you've got a double sort of challenge. So how do those projects actually prepare the grounds, that the several projects you talked about, prepare the grounds in the broader community to be able to implement such interventions where you're questioning society's norms, really?
Again, really good question. And that, I mean, it just speaks to the sort of many layers of complexity when you're thinking about how do we intervene effectively. The interventions that I was talking about have different approaches. So actually that the trial in Uganda had a very active community component. So engaging with key stakeholders, be it religious leaders, health officials, the police, and so on, to really try and shift that broader understanding and norm around the acceptability of violence. In some of the others, I think that the work is more focused. And then that, when you're in the sort of, but if you're thinking about sort of a, you know, the bigger plan, you'd be saying, well, actually, within a sort of national strategy, you'd be saying, what are the elements that are sort of attitudinal, normative at amongst different stakeholders that you want to see in place, and then what are the sort of more focused elements that you target at adolescents or health providers or whatever. I think as there's greater attention to the issue of violence, we are seeing countries develop national plans on addressing violence. There are sort of moves to really say, how do we work on a bigger scale to address some of the issues? That's not happening, but there's a lot of push for actually budgets and spend. We can't count on that, but it's, you know, there are different directions, different investments that are sort of pointing in the same way. I think the issue around norms more broadly is interesting, because I'm quite interested when we think about groups and they're having those discussions. It's who are the people who impact on what you do? So that sort of injunctive norm. And actually, how much does, when you form a group and you start, that group starts to have a process of critical dialogue, do they become then the reference points for members out of the group? Is other members of the group whose attitudes are becoming more progressive? And in some of the intervention work, there's a kind of very explicit plan where you say, well, let's do this group work and develop that sort of conscious raising and discussion and reflection. And then how do we try and facilitate a diffusion element where then that group interacts with the broader community to try and have a broader influence on attitudes around the acceptability of violence? And actually, I've done that in a sort of a different intervention approach in rural South Africa, where we were trying to get that combination of a community level effect and an individual effect. But I'm afraid I don't have all the solutions.
Hi, my name's Christine Dentz. I work for the Imperial Trust and I'm based at Charing Cross Hospital. My first question was really covered by the first question. I was going to ask you about the role of parents when you deal with all these adolescents, and I think you covered that. My second one was also fairly covered. But what I want to ask you is, how do you deal with tribal animosity? I work with a lot of Africans who have volunteered, worked out there in trials, in health centres, and they say it's a huge problem across the continent, really. So I'm just wondering, because you were talking about governments now trying to intervene, and just what are your thoughts about the tribal animosity that happens within a country itself when you're trying to implement trials like this, or trying to help the people? Does that make sense?
I'm trying to understand. I mean, I've been involved in a trial in Kampala. That was a community social change intervention. So it was really working with a bit like the one that had the share trial. And it was trying to say, how do we shift community norms? How do we impact on HIV risk behaviors and violence? And in that setting, there's a range of different religious groups, tribal groups, and the strategy is to work with everybody. Work, you know, this isn't an issue that is specific to, you know, one race, one religion, or anything like that. So it was really sort of working very holistically, and actually, you know, in terms of key stakeholders in that case, going across all the different religious faiths, and actually unpicking in each of those communities, what are the issues around norms around violence, around sexual activity, and supporting processes of critical reflection and dialogue. And in that case, I haven't shown you the results here, but we had a 52% reduction in the community level on levels of physical and sexual partner violence amongst women. So I think we can think these things are barriers, but you actually just have to work with everybody.
Over there. Did that answer your question about the tribal animosity? I just wondered if were you thinking more of there was difficulty getting different work groups to work together?
Yes.
Where
you've got
differences between groups, I suppose.
Because
I
think they don't like each other.
Mm. Is that something you've come across?
You know, you get one tribe with their family group, and they don't really care what happens over there with that.
Well, I mean, if I think about that study in Uganda, I mean, and there might be others who have more experience on this, but in that case, it's just working in the community, whoever's in the community. In some communities, it might be all one religious group, one tribal group, but it's not like everybody has to come together and, you know, hold hands. It's how do you just work across a range of different communities and in the different contexts and support that process of analysis. So actually, the kind of programming isn't necessarily about one joint meeting point. It's how do you diffuse out a reanalysis and work with different stakeholders and men and women who are more progressive in those communities to support a process of critical debate and dialogue. In those interventions in Uganda, though, what's interesting is they focus it on power to start with, the discussions. When they start talking about violence, their starting point is power. Who has power? Who doesn't have power? How do we use power well? How do we use power badly? To try and get over some of those just really immediate sort of biases and stereotypes to go, well, let's look more critically. Yeah, the local leader has power. Does he serve us well? Maybe not. You know, so actually there's different ways of engaging in those conversations that can help you, I think, get to some honest discussions and reflections. And that's the sort of, you know, I think, I evaluate interventions, and what I'm always impressed by is the skills of interventions working on the ground to really sort of think about, in this context, what's the way to start these sorts of discussions? And how do we not get into, these people are good, these people are bad, you know, women aren't perfect by any means. You know, I mean, we don't want to get in those sort of dichotomous assessments, but much more, what's underpinning this? What's going on? Are we happy about it? What do we aspire to? For very much thinking about aspirations, what do we aspire to in the future? And how do we help people to achieve those aspirations? Yeah.
Okay, thank you. We have a question over here. Hello.
Hi, I'm Angela Burnett, and I work at Freedom From Torture. So we work with survivors of torture from throughout the world. Thank you, that was excellent, Charlotte. I have actually two questions, which I hope is not too greedy. First of all, I wondered how conflict and migration impacts on adolescent girls. I wonder if you could say something about that. And my second question is that I've recently become a trustee of an organisation of Alive and Kicking, which works in Zambia, Kenya and Ghana, and gives employment to people through sewing leather footballs, often with messages about HIV, and also organises football-related activities for adolescents, both girls and boys, which are very much connected with HIV education. Mm-hmm. And so I was really interested in what you said about the impact of educational activities, and particularly the work of Stepping Stones and Creating Futures. So certainly I'll talk to them about that for their programs. But I wondered if you could say something about the length of time of engagement and the resources, because it's quite a small organisation. I'm just wondering what's possible, really, but also about thinking about partnerships.
Great. And Angela, lovely to see you. I think that first question is huge.
I know.
And, you know, I mean, in a way, we should just have a round discussion around that, because it's, you know, it's clearly critically important, and the vulnerabilities are multiple, and there's the whole migration, stages of migration, and clearly violence and issues around inequality are really centrally there. I'm now at DFID, and these are sort of questions we're asking ourselves quite actively, you know, and how do we think about, you know, in emergency responses, what do we do and what are the implications? But I don't have answers on that, but it's, you know, it's a huge issue. And it's not something I've researched, so I mean, I just don't want to pretend I know. But I know it'll be many. In terms of the issues, I mean, actually, it's a really good point you made, is more generally about sports-based interventions. So there are a few intervention models that are really trying to use sport as an entry platform to engage with adolescents. And there's sort of some quite interesting work in South Africa linked to that. Actually, partners in Strive in India are doing work both with boys and with girls around sport. It's interesting in India, because in that context, there's, for girls, it's actually getting girls into public spaces and actually giving them time to play, as well as then using that as a forum to think and sort of have discussions and create safe spaces to talk about issues around gender. In terms of the sort of livelihood, small enterprise, I think what the evidence points to is that alone you can't assume that'll have a gender transformative effect. So actually making, using that as an opportunity to go through those sorts of discussions, the sort of participatory activities, is the bit that I think makes a difference. It's that combination. This issue of, well, how much, how long, is the sort of million-dollar question that policymakers always ask. So stepping stones is quite long. Actually, the version that they used in creating futures is pared down a bit, so it's a bit shorter. So I think they've sort of adapted to try and be quite pragmatic. In an old, a set of older women, so the image trial that we did in South Africa, there we had 10 sessions that we added on to a microfinance intervention, and that had a significant impact on violence. So, and we're in the moment sort of adapting that and testing that in Tanzania. But I think that's the way that, sort of in a way, the sort of questions we're asking, you know, we're starting to get a sense that if we do loads of stuff, lots of people change. Now it's sort of, well, can we do a bit less and will we still get the same effects? But I can talk to you after and point you to some of those curricula and this issue of cost and how to facilitate, you know, who are the people to facilitate those sort of activities are always the sort of tricky questions when you get into thinking about resources and...
Thank you, that's okay. Excellent.
Thank you very much. Can I just check with the tech guys, have we got any questions online or from anybody watching? No, okay. Do we have another question here? Lady on the left, there's one at the back here. Sorry, thank you.
Hi, I'm Jasmine. I'm a medical student at Brighton and also former student at LSHTM. Thank you, it was a really interesting talk. I thought it was really interesting you mentioned about conditional cash transfers and comparing them to unconditional cash transfers, and actually the conditionality didn't seem to be that important, and actually it was more about the cash transfer itself. And I wonder what that, the implications of that for the pathway really on how it works for reducing HIV incidence and violence and things.
Yeah. Good question. I think when people looked at the pathways and the behavior linked to the Zomba trial, it actually looked like adolescent girls weren't actually having a lower number of, in the intervention communities, a smaller number of sexual partners than in the control. But actually, it's probably how risky those partners were. And I think that the sort of age difference was slightly less. So the sort of thinking is actually by having some disposable cash, girls were less reliant on having relationships with men who have money to access resources. So that was the sort of pathway. So that sort of transactional sex pathway is the sort of thinking about what happened. And if you've got, you know, girls having relationships with boys of a more similar age, or maybe where there's a sort of less of a power inequality, actually then maybe they're better able to negotiate sex and to negotiate condom use. This issue of conditionality and non-conditionality is something that's quite, you know, there's a lot of different interest. The sort of the condition element comes from sort of one of the motivations around that is sort of behavioral economics, this idea, can we sort of nudge people and create incentives for behavior? But actually often setting up a conditionality can be quite expensive. So, you know, if you're thinking about a government and you're saying, well, actually, do we, for example, in South Africa, we have, there are child protection grants, is there a value of adding a condition to that? Actually, that would cost a lot of money. Versus actually, are there other ways of just using, ensuring that those resources can be used to reduce HIV vulnerability just by encouraging girls to stay in school? So that issue of conditionality is, you know, is politically quite, it's also quite a bit, you know, a bit sensitive to say, actually, we'll withhold resources from some segments of the population if they don't behave, because are you then compounding vulnerabilities that maybe the people who have the hardest time actually responding to those conditions are those that actually you should be helping most. So it's the sort of conditional and unconditional. What's interesting though, if you think more broadly around sort of cash transfers and sort of social protection, is that's being rolled out across a number of sub-Saharan African countries. And there's some interesting work that Lucy Culver at Oxford with colleagues in South Africa is doing, for example, around cash to OVC and vulnerable households. So orphans and vulnerable, the sort of other vulnerable households that are just providing cash plus some care, and actually sort of has data suggesting that that combination focused on those vulnerable households has impacts on a range of different outcomes, including the sort of measures of that household's vulnerability, but also the sexual behaviour of adolescents in those households, reducing their HIV risk. So I would go for the unconditional, I guess I'm saying, but yeah, there's different perspectives on it.
Okay, thank you, Charlotte. Got a couple more questions. We'll try and keep them brief.
Okay, sorry.
Try and wrap up in a moment. Yeah.
Hi, my name's Natasha Lelibald. I'm from Institute for Global Health at UCL. I was just thinking about your slide, which had the map of the world and proportion of women who experience sexual violence, and the Indian subcontinent actually had even higher proportion of women experience sexual violence in sub-Saharan Africa. So are adolescent girls in those countries still the most at-risk population, or is there something unique about sub-Saharan Africa that's making these girls so vulnerable?
Okay, so I think that's a smart observation there. I mean, I think what you've got to recognize when you're thinking about the relationship between violence and HIV, it's not a one-on-one mapping. You know, our global map of the HIV doesn't look like the global map on violence. So in India, we have concentrated epidemics where most infection is amongst different key populations, be it sex workers, heteros, other men who have sex with men, injecting drug users. In that case, you've got an epidemic of violence. I mean, it's very high levels of violence. That's a public health concern, a human rights concern in its own right. In terms of its role in exacerbating HIV risk, it's going to exacerbate HIV risk where there's HIV. So if you look within the partnerships of injectors, or if you look at within sort of sex worker client relationships or sex workers relationships with steady partners, the issue of violence will be there and probably sort of compounding risk, but it's not sort of in the broader population. If that's a setting where there isn't much HIV, then it's not feeding into the transmission of HIV. In sub-Saharan Africa, you have generalized epidemic, you have population sort of, you know, greater than 1%, greater than 5%, whatever levels of HIV infection, then you're seeing this playing out at a broader level and where you see it amongst adolescents.
Okay, thank you, Charlotte. And one question back.
Good morning. Thank you for the interesting lecture. My name is Esther Jurgens from the Netherlands, from the Netherlands Society of Tropical Medicine and International Health. I'll try to keep it brief. I had two questions. I skipped one, and I have just a short one. If you could tell something about the differentiation between the age groups, because it's very different if you work with younger adolescents and the more older adolescents, and if you can just type out some interventions that would work more for the younger or the older, or did you look into that?
Yeah, I mean, it's a really good question. It's a really good question, and I think we do sort of within the adolescent field, there is, including my talk, that lack of sort of disaggregation and saying, well, what are we thinking about different age bands? Some of that comes from just the way when people aggregate data, so some of the global data that they sort of tend to use these uniform age bands. So if you're thinking about 15 to 24, you're spanning girls who may or may not, you know, sort of 15 to 18 may or may not be at school, may or may not be married, you know, different percentage may or may not be married. You've got that sort of 18 to 24 where, you know, what's happening then? Are they entering employment? Are they getting married? Are they trying to get pregnant? You've got quite critical phases of an adolescent's life. So actually, in terms of interventions, we have to get more specific. And so, I mean, you can probably guess from some of the interventions, they're targeted at different groups, so that, you know, the sort of creating features is a sort of that sort of 16, 18, sort of 20, I don't know the specifics of the ages, I'd have to check it, but, you know, we're saying how do we think about when kids are leaving school and they're entering employment? That's a phase where, you know, it's there's high HIV vulnerability, so what are the packages that we can put in place to address that? And actually in the HIV field, there's this sort of, well, we know, you know, we think there are benefits of keeping people in school. What's the graduation package? And what's our vision then of what happens when they leave school? And in some populations, we're seeing incidence really shoots up at that sort of age of leaving school. And so, I mean, I can't answer what's the packages by age, but it, you know, there is this sort of thinking.
Thank you.
And it's really important to break it down. And I mean, I get really frustrated by that band and some of the sort of definitions of adolescence that sort of, I think, are just combining too broad an age range.
And thank you, Charlotte. Given that there are so many, yeah, I guess the slide you had of the multiple pathways and the boys also involved as well as the girls, are there moves to look at pre-adolescent? I mean, are pre-adolescents being considered and targeted through interventions?
So, I mean, so that's a whole other set of questions about actually if you'd want to change gender relations and change expectations and relationships, where do you intervene? You know, and is it 12-year-olds? Is it 10-year-olds? There are sort of attitudinal surveys that suggest sort of social acceptance of violence starts quite young. And so what's the point? You know, is it in life skills that you, instead of just talking about how do you understand about how to get pregnant, not get pregnant, you talk about relationships, you think about how do you develop communication skills, how do you think about anger management? There's these sort of package of skills that actually that are being introduced into some school curricula that's trying to take a more holistic view of approaches to this issue. And actually in the UK, I know there's those sorts of initiatives as well.
Okay, I'm going to draw it to a close there. So I would all thank Charlotte for her presentation today.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Thanks. Charlotte. Excellent talk. Going to have a quick turnaround now. I know some of you aren't going to be staying for the rest of the day, so we'll get back onto the programme in about 2 or 3 minutes' time. I'm just going to grab a coffee. I'm probably going to be chairing again, aren't I, Jerry? Yes, thank you. So those who are staying, please reconvene in about 2 or 3 minutes. If you're staying, just stay where you are. But I think we still have got coffee and pastries outside, haven't we, Jerry? I'm allowed to get one.
Thank you for joining the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene for the 2015 Manson Christmas Lecture. If you want to find out more about the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene, including the details of other forthcoming events, please visit rstmh.org or follow @rstmh on Twitter. We hope you enjoyed this live video stream and look forward to welcoming you to future events at the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene.